Yo, welcome to another episode of Speak On It. I am your host, the mouthpiece of the Southeast, the one and only Mike Sean. Now, today, I got one of my homeboys in the building. Now, I've known this gentleman for over 15 years. He's been a family friend for a long time. He's a political juggernaut, and he wants to come on the show and give it to you guys raw and uncut. Without further ado, Mr. Brent, how's it going, sir?
It's going well, Deshaun. How are you?
Man, I'm doing good. I'm doing good, man. It's a crazy world out here. Crazy, crazy, crazy world, man.
Yeah, 2020 keeps rolling on.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. How's that Tennessee weather doing? How's that Tennessee weather up there?
Oh, man, it's been beautiful today.
Okay. Same here in Huntsville as well, man. 65, you know.
Sunshiny.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I can't wait for that snow. Yeah.
We'll see what happens.
Yeah, man. So, like I said, it's been a crazy, crazy week in sports and in politics. So I decided to go ahead and bring Brent on to the show so he can pretty much tackle some topics that we have. So the first question, Brent, what are your overall thoughts of the election results?
Well, just as I said, 2020 keeps rolling on and it does not disappoint. The election results were pretty much par for 2020, right? I think that anyone would have been happier with a blowout, regardless of which side you pull from. Just to skip all of this, all this legal bullshit that's going on and all the arguments. And, it would have been nice to have put this election to bed. But we are in the situation that we are in. I think that it's pretty clear that Biden's going to win. And that Biden Harris are going to be the next folks in power. So I'm pretty optimistic. You know, of course I am, mm-hmm. I am a Republican and a Trump fan and a conservative. but on the bright side, you got to look at the overall results, right? The Republicans picked up several seats in the House. And looks like they're going to keep control of the Senate. We'll see how those Georgia runoff races go. I think this election was a repudiation on Donald Trump's character, right? Mm. The voters have been heard. Enough of the orange man, right? Not so much Joe Biden is the candidate that everybody wanted. Uh-oh. Uh-huh. You still there, man? Because my phone.
Oh no, you're good. You're good. You're good.
Okay,
you're good.
My phone just said 20% battery. So anyways, I don't think that the Democrats have got a mandate just to go off and pull any sort of, left wing policies that they were, hoping to be able to put forth, especially since all of the polls were showing that they were going to, win seats in the House and take over the Senate and be able to push forward whatever kind of policies they wanted. Whether that would be, packing the courts or getting rid of the Electoral College or, any number of, the Green New Deal, any number of items that were, way left of center that would have been a possibility had, the election turned out differently. Mm-hmm. They got the White House. They mm-hmm. kept the House. But I don't think they've got a mandate to go forward with anything that's left of center. And Joe Biden mm-hmm. is pretty much a moderate. So mm-hmm. I think that, if we look at once again positively from my point of view, mm-hmm. Joe Biden has an opportunity to really. He's only going to be in office for 4 years if he can last that long. Shame. But he's got an opportunity to really pave his legacy as being the president that reunited mm-hmm. the country. After the last 4 years of all the craziness, right?
Yeah.
And
yeah.
If he can push a moderate agenda. And not go along with the squad and AOC and all of the left side of the party. And if you can really push a moderate agenda, I think that a lot of the division within the country can be healed and he will go down in history as the guy that can claim responsibility for it. So once again, I'm positive.
Gotcha.
Trying to look at this, with any sort of positive way that I can.
So on your Facebook timeline a couple of weeks ago, man, you have some crazy people on your timeline. Cause there's one person, he was basically saying that Biden was going to win Georgia and Texas with a landslide. And so I was like, wow, that's, I mean, you know, me being a progressive, I'm like, I don't know about Texas, maybe Georgia. But this guy was adamant about Biden winning Texas.
Well, it's the polls, you know, the polls were for the most part wrong. You know, when it comes down to it, Joe Biden did not win in a landslide. There wasn't a big blue wave. And yeah, a lot of the key races, especially for the Senate that were, you know, supposed to be locked in for the Democrats didn't go that way. So as far as the polls are concerned, I think they've really got a problem on their hands. This is two elections in a row that they were, you know, very wrong. And the fact of the matter is that they're the way that they go about conducting these polls via landline phone calls. To you know, there's a lot of science behind it, but who's got a landline and who are the people that are actually taking the time to answer these polls? And, you know, with the idea that the polls are skewed left, there's an awful lot of conservatives that, you know, are just not going to answer the polls at all, or are going to answer them incorrectly because they're embarrassed that they're embarrassed, or they are they feel endangered for supporting Trump or conservative ideas. So, you know, they've got to completely redo their, you know, the way that they go about conducting these polls. As a matter of fact, I heard that there are some polls that were a lot more accurate, and they were asking people, how do you think your neighbor's going to vote? Right. And that's a lot more accurate because, you know, it's not, okay, I'm not telling you that I'm going to support Trump because that makes me a bad person. Right. But my neighbor, my neighbor's definitely voting for Trump. So it changes up the dynamic altogether. So like I said, the polls were off. I think that, you know, with the entire narrative that has been pushed by, you know, CNN and MSNBC and the New York Times and the whole nine yards has been the country hates Trump, the country hates Republicans, and the country wants to move left. And once again, we can very much see that there was that we've had the country's had enough of the orange man. You know, Trump.
Why do you call him the orange man? You can't do that, man. I know.
It's orange man bad, right? It is the basic understanding that that Trump is just an all around terrible person, and that's been the narrative that has been shouted out from the highest hills from the day he was elected president. So, you know, yeah, Trump definitely has his faults, and you know, a lot of them definitely,
Yeah, I mean, you know, nobody's perfect, you know, and like with Trump, I mean, I think if he would have, you know, deactivated his Twitter and was like less vocal, I think he would have had a better shot, you know, but some of his antics, his grandstanding did kind of hurt him.
Well, he's his own worst enemy because his antics and his grandstands are what got him elected, right?
That's true. That's true.
His incredible character defects and his giant ego and unwillingness to follow the rules. And he does this, he does things his own way, you know, to the nth degree has gotten him to be a billionaire and gotten him to be a celebrity and got him to be this very powerful man who wound up in the White House. But it's those same things that helped to make him this shining star that have also made everybody go, who the hell did we elect? Because, you know,
but the thing with Trump is he was able to like even grab more votes, because what I was thinking was there's no way he's, you know, he's going to win again because he's abandoned coalitions that are in place or that can be built on winning the election. But he was able to strip and scrape more votes this time around.
The only demographic that he got fewer votes for this time was white men.
You know what's crazy? Remember back in 2008, white men overwhelmingly supported Barack Obama. When he decided to go the gay route, as far as like for gay rights, that's when he lost their support for two elections. You know, so wow. I mean, for Trump to lose the white male vote, that says a lot.
Yeah, well, he didn't lose all of it, but
no. Right. But I mean, but now he did gain white women though.
Yes, he did. I think that a lot of it has to do with, you know, speaking as a white man who supports Trump, I'm tired of being labeled a racist just because I support support Trump, you know, and that's kind of, again, been the narrative. You know, Trump is bad. Trump is racist. Trump is sexist. Anybody who supports Trump must be those things. And you know, I'm sure there are a lot of people that voted for him in 2016 because he was the lesser evil compared to Hillary in their point of view.
Yeah.
That said, you know what? Enough is enough. And, you know, Joe Biden is better than Hillary, so I'm going to vote for Joe Biden. I think that's probably what happened.
Now for me, everybody, like I said, I've known Brent for over 15 years. I started working for a company and Brent was my trainer. And I remember my first day, we had to go pick up a woman in Butler Terrace. And at the time, Brent had, he looked like a skinhead, all right? He had low haircut, you know, so I mean, but he was one of the ones who didn't shy away from going into certain areas, picking up, you know, black people or just helping out in general. Every business venture that I've ever done, Brent's been there for me, you know? It's just one of those things where I don't believe that every Trump supporter is a racist, just like every Biden supporter is a non-racist. That's just not true, because there was probably millions of Biden supporters who voted for him that are racist. I mean, it is what it is, you know? So I don't think any one political party owns the racism sticker.
You know? Right. There's no political party that is running on racism. And there's no political candidate who's saying, if I get elected, that I'm going to enact policies which are inherently racist. So, you know, listen, once again, I support Trump, but I think he's an asshole. Okay. I think he's got a ton of character flaws. But yeah. I like his policies, and I like the things that he said he was going to work towards. And I was impressed with the fact that he really followed through on so many of his campaign promises. You know, when I voted for him in 2016, I had such low expectations that he was ever going to be able to get anything accomplished. But the one thing that, you know, made me support him all the way was the idea that he was going to nominate, or, you know, work towards getting conservative justices, right? We were on our side were lucky that he got to put in three, right? But he got to do so many other things, and he was able to work really towards doing so many of the things that he promised to do. So I was impressed with that.
Let me ask you this though, Brent, because whenever I talk to conservatives, they always talk about his policies, but when I ask them which specific, you know, policy that they endorsed, they never can give me one. Well, on a personal level, it's like when people say, you know, I know your policies, we've had these discussions and whatnot, but when people say policies and I ask them, and then they say, you know, well, I don't want my taxes to go up. And then you're like, well, dude, you're making like $25,000 a year.
Right. Yeah. Well, yeah. Hey, let's start with taxes. You know, overall, like I said, he's been much more of a conservative than I ever thought he would have been. Once again, I had extremely low expectations of what he was going to be able to do. Mm-hmm. Tax cuts. You know, I saw that affect me, you know, in a big way when those tax cuts went through. I saw that and have seen that and continue to see that affect the business that I am in. Mm-hmm. You know, before the tax cuts, we were hiring people on it was $8.35 an hour. Okay. Yeah. 3 months after the tax cuts went through, and after our benefits packages got changed up for management as well as associates and education benefits, a whole lot of increases in benefits for associates. Mm-hmm. That now the hourly rate for new hires is $12.35 mm-hmm. an hour.
And this is in Tennessee too, or this is nationwide probably.
It's a union company. So okay, the unions are going to be regional. So this is going to be, you know, in the state of Tennessee.
That's good, still, though. I mean, for Tennessee, I mean, Tennessee, their cost of living is similar to Huntsville or to Alabama in general. Probably a little bit better, but that's really good. $4 increase is really good.
$4, and like I said, it was directly attached to the fact that they lowered the corporate taxes and the cost of doing business for my company went down considerably. And as a result, they increased wages. So, you know, that was right off the bat. But overall, just his idea of America first, and you know, working to renegotiate trade treaties with China, getting us out of the TPP, sticking it to our allies in NATO and saying, listen, you guys need to pony up on the amount of money that you put in for defense. Going to Germany was building a pipeline to buy gas and oil from Russia. And that was totally against the treaties that we had through NATO. The whole idea of uniting for the European and countries together with the United States was against the Russians and the Soviets, as it was, all of their aggression and whatnot. So we had all these treaties of all of these allies together that we're going to trade together and we're going to unite together. Well, Germany was going outside that treaty to buy gas from Russia.
Yes.
Well, Trump went to Merkel and said, what are you doing? We were sitting on an ocean of natural gas and you're buying your gas from the enemy. I mean, so once again, sticking it to our allies and making sure that they were ponying up and putting in enough money in defense spending as per our treaties, holding them accountable, renegotiating trade deals, putting America first and trying to get manufacturing back in the United States, getting us out of the Paris Climate Accord once again, because that did not benefit the United States. We were actually the country that was the most hurt by that agreement. Mm-hmm. You know, a decision after decision, which once again put the American worker first and the American people first.
Yeah, and it's kind of funny because, like you said, he's been much more conservative than you thought he was initially, and a lot of that has to do with how he conducted business before he became president. So do you feel that that sometimes the conservatives, once he got into office, they were able to string him along, and he really wasn't this radical that, or this straight shooter that we thought he was going to be? Do you think he kind of conformed to conservatism in a sense?
I think the Trump plays for Trump, right? And when Trump was a Manhattan real estate mogul and rubbing elbows with all the richest and most powerful people in the country, he was a Democrat and he supported whatever he needed to support and gave money to whatever politicians he needed to give money to in order to help himself out. When he got elected, he realized that if he wanted to be reelected, if he wanted to be the darling of the conservatives and be loved by all the Republicans, he needed to do certain things. That's his MO. He's not a conservative. He just wants to impress the conservatives.
And you know what's so funny? And I'm glad you said that too, because like I have a lot of friends who are right leaning and they call themselves conservatives and they're also Trump supporters. Most of your true conservatives, they will say that he's not really a conservative, but he, like you said, he does what he has to do. So the notion of him being a conservative since like the 1980s is just false. And I think a lot of people who are just being hip to Trump, they feel that he's been a conservative his whole life.
Trump wants to win, okay? And whatever sport he's playing, okay, he doesn't care. He just wants to win, okay? He'll cheat. He'll do whatever he needs to do, but he wants to win. And right now, he's on my fucking side. So by all means, win, 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 and do whatever you need to do to get it done.
Like, so let me ask you.
I don't care.
Hey, what was Eddie Guerrero's theme song? We lie, we cheat, we steal.
I think that's Trump's theme song.
Oh, man. Hey, so like moving on, like, do you think his refusal to concede undermines the political process? Because again, folks, me and Brent were really close. I think the day of the election, well, that night you were saying, oh, it's done. It's over for Trump. And I was like, well, you know, wait, calm down. Let's see what's going on. But you were so adamant about, I think it's over. So you kind of like foresaw that even before the whole lawsuits and everything went going on. So do you think now what we know about, you know, Trump and the Electoral College and all that good stuff, do you think him conceding undermines our political process?
Well, the text messages that we were doing on election night and in the next day where I said that he was that it was over was just based on the math of the looking at what was going on and the route to victory. And it appeared to me, I guess this would have been Wednesday, as the votes continue to be tabulated and whatnot, that his best route to victory would have had him be losing it by 4 electoral votes.
Okay.
And it turned out to be, you know, Biden had beat him even worse than that. So, you know, that was once again based on the information that I had at the time. So, you know, it was pretty apparent, you know, on Wednesday when Michigan and Wisconsin were leaning, you know, towards Biden, and then since he had won Arizona, and it looked like he was going to win Nevada, that it was just impossible for Trump to do it. The math just didn't work out if he couldn't get those states, even if he got Pennsylvania.
Yeah.
You know, even if he got Pennsylvania and Georgia, without Arizona and Nevada, and Michigan and Wisconsin, there's no way for him to get it. So, so do I feel that his inability to concede the election is threatening our democracy? No, I think that there is no law that states that the loser of the election has to make a phone call and say, well, it's been a great race, but looks like you won. There's nothing that says that they have to do that. There's a legal process outlined in the Constitution on the second Tuesday, or excuse me, the first Tuesday following the first Monday of the of November, there will be an election. And then on December 8th, the states have to certify their votes. So between Election Day and December 8th, it allows for all the states to count up all their votes, for there to be any sort, if the election is contested, for there to be any legal action, any lawsuits, for them to work all that out, any recounts. It gives them a whole month to figure everything out, and they have to certify their votes by December 8th. On December 8th, it's certified. The election results are official. At that point in time, the electors are chosen. And then what is it? December 14th, the electors get together and choose a president.
Yes. Yes.
It's written in the Constitution. The, you know, CNN and Fox News and the AP don't get to decide who the president is. It's like you're at a Super Bowl party, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And the Trump's team is 1:59 left in the fourth quarter, and they're down by 15 points.
Mm-hmm.
The game's over.
Yeah.
Right. And everybody on the Biden sideline are happy as clams, and they're celebrating, right?
Mm-hmm.
And people are leaving the parties early because the game's over.
Traffic.
But they're trying to beat traffic, right? Okay. Champagne is being popped, and everybody's happy, and they're going out in the streets and celebrating. But there's still 1:59 left on the clock. Okay. The game doesn't end just because, you know, just because people think that it's over. Trump's got to throw a Hail Mary pass, get a 2-point conversion,
get an
onside kick, throw another Hail Mary pass, and get another 2-point conversion in order to win. It ain't going to happen, but the game's not over. There's still time left on the clock, and therefore to say that the game is over is not right. It's not true.
Yeah.
You know, and so, yes, we have had a tradition, let's say in the past 50 years, that when the TV people say so-and-so is the next president, you know, the loser picks up the telephone and concedes. You know, of course, that didn't happen in 2000.
No.
Because what happened in Florida, right? Yeah. And Hillary Clinton didn't do it till 4:35 in the morning. But we've had a tradition where that's happened.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Well, Trump is anything but traditional. Right. And so to expect that he is going to be a good sport about this and to concede the election before every single legal avenue has been exhausted is ridiculous.
You know what I find funny, though? Like, he knows what the final outcome is going to be, but it's kind of like he's stringing along a lot of people because they're so impressionable. You know, me personally, I could care less if he does a concession speech. At the end of the day, more than likely, his stuff is going to be out on the front lawn come January 20th. And I think a lot of times people, we as just individuals, we want good sportsmanship. So I guess even though Hillary lost and maybe she had waited till 4:35 in the morning, even though she was up by, say, 3 million votes, the popular vote, she still had the decency to go ahead and say, you know what, I lost. Here you go. Boom, boom, boom. But of course, it'd be a little bit different because Trump is the incumbent. So I don't know, man. It's just, I find it hilarious to me.
Well, once again, it's a tradition, but it's not. Stacey Abrams never conceded when she lost the gubernatorial race in Georgia, and nobody freaked out about that.
Now, I do agree with that, but that was some buffoonery going down in Georgia. She didn't do it for two years later or something like that.
Let's talk about buffoonery, okay? And that's where we're at right now. So hold on, let's. So there's allegations of voter fraud, We got to understand the parties that are filing suit. We've got the Trump campaign that is filing suit, not stating that there's fraud, mm-hmm. not stating that there was massive voter fraud, because once again, there's no evidence that we have been privy of at this point in time of massive voter fraud. And there never has been evidence that's come forward to say that there's been widespread voter fraud. That's one of the great things about the American system and the way that we have our elections. The Electoral College makes that difficult, right? Because even if you had this huge voter fraud, plan in place, you would have to do it all over the country in all kinds of, in all different states and all the, it would be so massive for you to actually pull off a victory, right?
Yeah.
If it was a popular vote situation, then you could do it in one place, right? You throw an extra California. 10 million votes in over here, right? And be done with it. You can do it in California, right?
Texas, yeah. Mm-hmm.
So we've got that going for us. So what Trump is saying is that, and it's the same argument that that the Supreme Court decided in the Florida 2000 case, and that is the 14th Amendment, which states that all votes have to be counted the same. All ballots have to be treated the same. You cannot give preferential treatment to certain ballots over others. Mm-hmm. And what the argument that's being made is that mail-in ballots were treated differently than in-person ballots. And that because of the fact that there was all kinds of different laws, which allowed all these different precincts to cure ballots that came in and whether or not those ballots came in on the right date. And also, they were saying that there's from county to county and from precinct to precinct, they had different standards for verifying signatures and for handling those ballots, which is understandable because this is the first time that there's been a widespread mail-in vote, right?
Yes.
So there are a lot of places that were winging it. This is the first time they'd ever done it this much, or they got in 10, 20, 30 times more than they had ever gotten in before. And so the process all changed. Well, the problem was it's not a uniform policy, not a uniform process for all of the different counties. So what they're arguing is, how can we count all of these ballots if they were treated improperly, which means if they were counted or if the signatures were verified or if they were handled differently from county to county, which basically says if some of them were, if they were handled differently. And the 14th Amendment says that all ballots have to be treated the same. So there's that. They're going after they're going after all these mail-in ballots based on the 14th Amendment, and they've got to win a whole bunch of court cases in a whole bunch of different states for it to happen. Is it going to happen? Probably not. Mm-hmm. But that's the number one thing. The second thing is, so during all of this COVID craziness, the governors and the secretaries of state were basically given a whole lot of unconstitutional powers to make laws for COVID, right? They were able to mandate new mask mandates and shut down bars and restaurants and this, that, and the other. And they were able to expedite all of it past the legislation because everybody said, yeah, fix the problem.
Yeah.
Well, in their exuberance to pass all of these COVID-related laws, they started changing election laws. And the changes to the election laws that they made were based on mail-in votes in an effort to ensure that people could continue to vote without going to the polling stations. Mm-hmm. Well, that's not constitutional. the legislatures, the state legislatures are the only ones that are constitutionally allowed to change voter laws. So what they're trying to say is any mail-in ballot that came in and that was accepted and verified based on the new laws, can't be counted. Once again, I'm not a lawyer, and I don't know whether this is going to fly or whether it's going to make a difference. Mm-hmm. I don't know how the hell they're going to be able to quantify how many of these ballots were valid as opposed to invalid. But that's the argument that the Trump campaign is making. Now, as far as voter fraud is concerned, there are, independent citizens who are filing lawsuits all over the country. and there are some shady lawyers who are filing lawsuits, saying, my dog voted. My dog got a ballot. There's all these dead people voting.
Yeah. There was one lady who came out. She said, I'm not dead. I know. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
I'm not saying that any of that is valid. I'm not saying that any of it has traction. I'm just stating that there is a legal precedent. There's a legal process for all of that bullshit to get worked out. And that's where we're at right now. Now, each state has to certify their vote by December 8th, which means the burden is on each state to work through all these legal cases and investigations and recounts. They're doing a recount in Georgia right now.
Yes. But
work through all this garbage as fast as they can so that they can get their vote certified by December 8th.
Mm-hmm.
Because if they are unable to certify their vote by December 8th, then their electors don't get to participate in the election. And so that is, adds a whole different level to the mathematical equations on, well, then what the hell is it going to take to win? Is it, it's not 270 anymore. If the 20 electorates from Pennsylvania, don't get to vote, then I guess it's 250. And then you got to start rumbling and going and redoing all the math. So there's a lot of stuff that's going on right now. There's a thousand people saying a thousand different things, and you don't know who to believe and what's real. But once again, we live in a wonderful country, and there's a legal process, and it's all written out, and they're working through it. And on December 8th, we're going to find out who the official winner is. It's probably going to be Joe Biden. And at that point in time, he's going to become the president. Well, the electors will be selected on December 14th. They will vote. He'll become the president elect and the transition will begin. That's the process.
Yeah. And I was watching, I think, the news, and, they had the MAGA marches, and they were on that keep hope alive, So I thought that was kind of cute. I do think that people are kind of worried about the whole transition process. I think that behind the scenes, the Trump administration, they are working with the Biden people, probably not to the extent that Biden people would want them to work with them, but they are probably giving up some information for a smoother transition. And I think we'll see a lot of stuff come about come, what, December 8th, December 14th. So yes. Moving on, what do you think a Biden presidency will look like? I know you said you're optimistic. What do you think that looks like?
Well, there's a lot of caveats here. Because you got to say, if Joe Biden is able to serve out his entire 4 years.
Hey, man, look, age is a man. You can't be doing that.
There's a very clear option that one of these days he's going to say, you know what, this is too much for me, resign, and then Kamala Harris will become president. Or they use the 25th Amendment and they say he's not fit for office. And then Kamala Harris becomes president.
Yeah.
There's a lot of different scenarios there, blah, blah, blah. But okay, if he is going to be president for 4 years, I think that, once again, he does everything that he can to be Lunchbox Joe, right? To stand up there and be, I'm the moderate president. What's that?
I'm the people's champ.
I'm the moderate working man's Joe. I'm from Scranton. I carry my lunchbox on the train every day. Look at me.
That sounds like he's from Georgia.
He's gonna do his thing, you know, to try to unite the country, and he's going to you know, not engage in a whole bunch of contentious you know, policy changes. He's going to get us back in the Paris Climate Accord. He's going to do as little as he can to placate the left, while doing as much as he can to not step on any mines and get himself into any trouble and try to unite the country. I think that that's going to be his main focus, to really contrast himself with the orange man. Orange man bad, Joe Biden good. Look at me and look how healthy the country is and how we're healing and we're getting together and you know, look how much better the 4 years are going to be under Joe Biden. COVID's going to come to an end. They're going to get in a vaccine and it's not going to be a problem anymore. The economy's going to recover because it has to. And he's going to be able to take responsibility for all of that. Mm-hmm. The last thing I think he's going to want to do is to piss off half the country again. The last thing that the Democrat Party is going to want him to do is to piss off half the country again. Mm-hmm. He's got a real opportunity to ensure that in 2024, Kamala or whoever the Democrats choose, mm-hmm, is a shoo-in if he can create a giant coalition.
Yeah.
And the only way he's going to be able to do that is to govern from the middle.
Which, traditionally, that's how Democrats have governed. I mean, well, you look at Clinton and you look at Obama. Hell, even Bush, he wasn't too extreme, if you think about it. He wasn't really to the right. He was center right. But I don't know. When was the last time we really had a Democrat that governed to the far left? Roosevelt, maybe?
I think that it has to do with rhetoric. You know, Obama had some pretty progressive rhetoric. Now, the policy changes that he was able to make or that he pursued were pretty centrist, right? The question is, was he unable to get his progressive policies enacted that he wanted to do? Did the Democrat Party not want him to do that?
Mm-hmm.
I can't answer those questions.
Yeah, who knows?
You're right. You're right when the historians look back on an Obama presidency, as far as policies and whatnot, he was a pretty centrist president, but his rhetoric was very progressive. And his rhetoric is what, you know, created the Tea Party. His rhetoric was what created all of the voters who voted Trump in. There was an awful lot of progressive talk, which scared an awful lot of people into voting for the opposite, which was, you know,
Donald I think Trump. The Tea Party was they were there, but they became more vocal once that Affordable Care Act passed.
Yeah,
they started drumming up, you know, their own.
Well, stuff. Yeah. Look, we got this guy comes in. You know, he's got all this leftist progressive rhetoric. He passes health care. Next thing you know, we're going to be a socialist country. We're going to be communist, and it got the whole thing rolling, right?
It's going to take the guns away.
But with what? Once again, it was all, you know, Obama was a great speaker, but Obama had his rhetoric was all progressive. He spoke an awful lot about very progressive topics. He wasn't able mm-hmm. to get all that stuff done, but mm-hmm. there was the fear, and he scared enough people,
mm-hmm.
That they felt that voting in Clinton was going to be an extension of mm-hmm. Of his leftist ideas, which once again you look back on it, he didn't pass a whole lot of progressive legislation. There wasn't a lot of policies that took us closer to socialism, other than the Affordable Care Act, which was just a crazy bill, which solved some problems in our crazy healthcare system, but exasperated a lot of other problems.
Mm-hmm. So, do you think Kamala Harris? You said you don't think Joe's going to make it past 4 years. So do you think Kamala Harris will become like the strongest vice president that we've had since Cheney?
I think that, yes. I think that she is going to do more as a vice president than we've seen anyone do, mm-hmm. maybe other than Cheney. But
maybe Bush Sr.
The Democrat Party is going to position her to be a shoo-in for 2024. That makes the most sense.
Mm-hmm.
She's going to be on the camera. She's going to be on the news. She's going to be doing a whole lot more of the stumping and a whole lot more of the FaceTime than Joe. Because, you know, let's be honest. He's going to be sitting in the White House, staring out the window, not knowing what's going on.
Oh, you mean like how Reagan was from 84 to about 88?
There you go. You could.
Yeah. I mean, you know, there's you only have so much energy when you are, you know,
that age.
35. I mean, it is, you know.
So yes. Do I think that they say that Kamala Harris is the most progressive member of the Senate, or at least her voting record shows that she's the furthest left? Either way, I don't think that the Democrat Party is going to allow her or Joe to move left because they want to get a bigger coalition. They want to get more people under their tent to ensure that in 2024 she gets elected. Now, what happens in 2024? That's a different story. And we'll discuss that at a later date.
Yeah, but I think Trump's going to run again.
And that's also an option. That's also another option. Which is, once again, let's talk about the idea that Trump's not going to leave and it's going to be a civil war.
He has to leave. He's going to leave, man. They're going to drag his ass out.
He's not going to die on that hill. He's got way too many plans and way too much money to make and way too much fame to give up now. He's not going to allow this to destroy him. He's going to allow this to catapult him into the next level of his crazy career. Now, whether that's going to be the Trump News Network.
Yeah, I've heard rumblings of that.
Or whether he's going to immediately go out on the campaign trail and start stumping for 2024, that remains to be seen. But let's get through this election first.
I think that's what he's going to do, because hell, he's been campaigning for 4 years. I mean, he's been having rallies. That's in him. That's what he's going to do.
There's nothing better in his life than to be standing at a podium, having thousands of people shout, "We love you! We love you!" There's nothing that he can do. There's nothing that can outmatch that. So yeah, regardless of whether he runs in 2024, he could even fake like he's going to run in 2024 just so he can keep campaigning.
Oh man, that'd be hilarious if Pence decides to run and they're opposite of each other. But I don't think that's going to happen.
Nah,
I think Ted Cruz will probably run again.
Ted Cruz, Dan Crenshaw in Texas, the guy with the one eye.
Yeah.
He's going to be president one of these
days.
You
think so?
Oh, that guy's great.
What about Buttigieg? Do you think he has a future in the next 10, 15 years?
I think that he towed the party line and did exactly what they asked him to do in getting out of the primary and allowing Joe Biden to get the nomination. I think he was promised an awful lot in order to do that. He's going to be around for a while. And once again, a Dan Crenshaw, Pete Buttigieg, fight in 2024 or 2028 would be great.
Yeah, definitely. And like with Buttigieg, time wounds heals. There was a situation in his when he was mayor that I think a black, a cop, they were basically covering up a story, and that kind of like hurt him with the black community. But I think that in the next 10 years, people will forget about that and he'll be able to prosper. I mean, because he's early 40s probably.
Yeah, he's young. You know, he's well spoken.
Yeah.
He's a veteran. He's gay. So he's got all these things going for him. I think he's got a bright future.
Definitely. Last question, man. So, you know, you're from Texas,
right.
Texas. So in college, you know, were you like a DJ Screw fan? What kind of fan were you, man? I love Texas hip hop.
Not a huge hip hop fan. However, I did listen to some DJ Screw in college. Gonna be a baller and a shot caller with 28 blades on my Impala, but yeah. You know, but of course screwed way down. But yeah, no, I had a lot of friends in the dorms and whatnot, and we used to listen to that music all the time. But yeah, like I said, I'm not the biggest hip hop fan, but definitely familiar with DJ Screw.
Yeah, it's kind of like with anything. If you're from Texas, you love, certain acts, be it hip hop or country. You know, if you're a hip hop fan in California, you're gonna like that type of hip hop. But yeah, man, that concludes the show, man. I definitely want to appreciate you for coming on, man, and just having a good time and keeping it level headed, so to speak.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, we've been able to do this for a long time. We've been having these conversations since
2008
and McCain. 2007,
man. Hey, back in the day, man, before I even got to work, man, I would have printouts that Brent gave me, bigging up, a certain political proponent or a political pundit or whatnot. And, Brent definitely put me on to some different things. He was the first person I saw that would call into a conservative radio station just to wail on the host. So Brent's one of those, fair and balanced, man. Anybody can get it. And one last thing too, man. I love the fact that you're open to learning about different people. I remember I put you on Malcolm X a few years back. And, a lot of people, they might say, oh, man, Malcolm X was this, Malcolm X was that. But you actually embraced knowing about him. And I definitely respect that for you.
Well, I'm always happy to learn new things and learn about new people. And, especially history and it helps us to understand better, where we are at today. And gives us a better ability to really figure out, read the writing on the walls and read between the lines, because there's so much information out there, and exactly, you got to be able to take bits and pieces from the left side and the right side and whoever is trying to explain reality and weave it together and to something that you understand.
Exactly. Once again, Brent, appreciate it, man. Rocket City Network, we out.